amendments, and in the region, in the Latin American and the Caribbean region, we have still four countries that yet to ratify the amendments, one of the amendments, and we hope to achieve this late this year or early next year. Secondly, I would like to talk about shortly about the success of the Montreal Protocol phasing out these substances that deplete the ozone layer. And you can see here in this graph how drastically the reduction has been. There are two colors there. The yellow color is Article 5 parties, developing countries' consumption, and you can see how it has been coming down, and the green part is developed countries, and they have also completely phased out the use of ODSs. You can see in the right hand side of the graph that how the world has managed to phase out or reduce 97 or over 97%. According to some measures, is 98% the historical levels of use of these substances. I would also like to show you in a map, just a geographical way, how was the consumption in 1990, in 2000, and in 2010. The red colors the darker colors, red and darker colors, are higher consumption, and the green is much lower consumptions. So you can see from 1990-2000 how the shade of the world is changing and the colors are changing until we get to 2010, in which basically China is the one that is being highlighted there as gray, and which is now the biggest consumer, producer and consumer of these substances. So this is a very quick graphic way to show the success of the Montreal Protocol in terms of reduction of the consumptions. I would now like to move to the next key achievement of the ozone layer, and this is only good news, is that the ozone layer really is on its way to recovery. And I would like to quickly to use this to introduce one element, and it is the influence of climate change into the work that governments are doing, phasing out, protecting the ozone layer and phasing out ODSs. In the first part of this graph, you can see the historical levels of concentrations of ozone-depleting substances in the atmosphere, in the stratosphere. You see how it was going all the way up and then coming down, and this is, well, let me use this. This is now, this is as of today, and you can see how around 10 years ago this reached a peak and continued to decrease. So we are, that's what science says today, that this is the projected reduction of chlorine equivalent in the stratosphere. Science also tells us that CO2 concentrations in the atmosphere are growing rapidly, and this is the projected, according to the IPCC, the projected CO2 increase in the atmosphere. We can also see the behavior of the ozone in October in the Antarctic, the total ozone of October in the Antarctic. You can see how it has continuously to come down until it reached a downward here, and then it's slowly projected to increase in the Antarctic. This is the behavior of the total ozone in the northern mid-latitudes, and you see how it has come down and is projected to increase. And this has to do with what Professor Haggard and Lawrence was saying before, which is the the behavior of the ultraviolet radiation in the mid latitudes, northern mid latitudes. What I would like to say here is that the influence of climate change, it will be absolutely the most important influence that we will be seeing in the future into the ozone layer. The governments of the world have done a great job reducing these ozone depleting substances. And then the influence of climate change is that it will become the determinant factor in the future. And this, there is the need of much more research on how those processes will influence each other in the stratosphere at the chemical, physical, and other levels. The fourth key achievement that I would like to mention is the damage or the adverse effects to human health that the Montreal Protocol is giving us, and that we usually take it for granted. But the fact is that the impact on the damages to human health, terrestrial ecosystems, aquatic ecosystems, biogeochemical cycles, as air quality, the materials, etc., has been averted. And I would like to give you an example of some estimates that have been done. And in fact, it has been estimated that tens of millions of cases of non-fatal skin cancer and cataracts have been avoided due to the Montreal Protocol. And in the United States alone, there has been a study that shows that more than 6.3 million cases of skin cancer deaths would have been avoided by 2065, and the cost of that was estimated during that time period. But also, and very importantly, they estimated that more than 22 million additional cataract cases would have been avoided of people born, Americans born between 1985 and the year 2100, so 22nd century. I would like now to rapidly move into one of the less known achievements of the Montreal Protocol, and a very important achievement. To illustrate the contribution of the ODS, the ozone depleting substance reductions, to the efforts to protect climate change, it is necessary to introduce something that you may be very familiar with, but others will not be. So I will need to introduce a little bit of the jargon of climate change for me to explain these two graphs. First, it is important to understand that, as I said, that many chemicals, ozone depleting chemicals, are also global warming, have global warming potential. And in order to compare the global warming potential of different substances, their impact is scaled in comparison to the impact of the of a molecule of carbon dioxide, and such that the impacts are can be measurable. So what I am going to, with this little explanation, what I'm going to show is these two graphs. The first one, we are using the mass weighted emissions of the ODSs. This is the historical records of the consumption of ODSs. This is the historical record. And then this is the projected situation, should have not been not under the absence of the Montreal Protocol. This is by mass weighted, but that one is by global warming potential weighted emissions. And here you can see, again, this is the historical use of emissions of ODSs, or the total production and consumption of ODSs. And this is what would have been in the absence of the agreement in 1987 of the Montreal Protocol. I would like to direct your attention to the year 2010 as an example. This is up to there, the red line is the current use of ozone depleting substances in terms of climate change. And this up to here is the savings in 2010. And these savings alone are between 5 and 6 times the target of the Kyoto Protocol on its first commitment under full compliance. Here is the target of the Kyoto Protocol, which is 2 gigatons per year, and this is the savings as calculated, as estimated by the scientists in this graph. So it's some huge contribution or a huge avoidance of emissions that would have damaged the not only the ozone layer but also the climate system. So that's enough of achievements. I would like now to drive your attention, and I hope none of you are falling asleep so far. I don't see anyone. Maybe Miriam was falling asleep, or maybe you were just leaning into Philippe's shoulder. Now, I would like to rapidly move into some of the special features of the Montreal Protocol to try to explain what is behind these monumental achievements. One very important feature of the Montreal Protocol is what we refer to as the start and strengthen approach. The Montreal Protocol started with baby steps of reducing consumption of CFCs by only 50% and also by freezing the production and consumption of another ozone depleting substances, the halons, which are widely used in all the fire extinguish systems. So that one, this was only to be freeze. But over these 24 years of implementation of the Montreal Protocol, the protocol has been strengthened several times. 6 times it has been adjusted, and 4 times it has been amended. Now, the Montreal Protocol controls 96 chemicals, and the Montreal Protocol is requiring to phase out totally all those 96 chemicals. So, quite often in the history of the implementation of the Montreal Protocol, one substance was added to the Montreal to the protocol with no impact or very little responsibility of the governments to later strengthen the protocol to get to mandate to phase out that substance. And indeed, many of the decisions of the parties on strengthening the Montreal Protocol have been based on the latest assessment of information on scientific, environmental, technological, and economic aspects of the ozone layer and its recovery. So there is a kind of a virtual cycle here. Start on a strengthened principle, but the strengthen is based upon the assessments, scientific assessments done by scientists and experts around the world. These scientific assessments are done at least every 4 years, and they provide the platform, the decision-making platform to the parties in taking decisions and looking forward into the implementation of the protocol. So we have 3 assessment panels, the scientific assessment panel, the environmental effects, and the technology and economic assessment panel. And even in the technology and economic assessment panel, we have several technical options committees of experts in the different sectors, which provide the parties with the latest state-of-the-art information for them to take the decisions. We are getting very close to the final slide, so please don't fall asleep yet, okay? Another feature that I would like to refer to in the Montreal Protocol is the innovative financial mechanism of the Montreal Protocol. This financial mechanism enables or has enabled the compliance of developing countries, and have enabled also the forging of very, very strong partnerships in the Montreal Protocol. The mechanism, this mechanism of the Montreal, the financial mechanism, is the first of its kind, first in the world of its kind. And this slide shows the progressive replenishment of the multilateral fund. You can see that it has been replenished seven times. Close to $3 billion have been contributed by the donor countries into the multilateral fund, and these funds have been used to enable compliance with the Montreal Protocol, enable compliance of our developing countries through different projects. And I would like to also to say that this year the parties are discussing and negotiating the latest replenishment of the multilateral fund for the period that will cover 2012 to 2014. So this is a very important issue on the agenda of the meeting of the parties later on the year in November. The achievements of the fund and the innovations that this multilateral fund for the implementation of the ozone layer has of the Montreal Protocol has been providing is fantastic. The key characteristics of the fund is that it pays for the additional or incremental cost incurred by developing countries in their efforts to comply with the Montreal Protocol obligations. It is managed by an executive committee made up by seven developing countries representatives, which are elected periodically on a yearly basis, and the projects that are approved by the executive committee are supported by the agencies that we, UNDP, UNEP, UNIDO, and the World Bank. And the achievements of the fund are fantastic. You can see in the overhead several of the achievements. More than 6,000 projects have been and activities have been carried out. $2.9 billion of funds have been allocated or transferred, and capacity building of institutional and strengthening, and this global networks of Ozone offices around the world that have brought into the Montreal Protocol a lot of new blood into the implementation of the protocol. So the network of Ozone offices of the Caribbean and Latin America is one of those that has been funded through the multilateral fund. Another key feature of the Montreal Protocol is the non-compliance procedure. The application of the non-compliance procedure is overseen by a group of 10 parties serving on the implementation committee. Again, this is another institution that is completely managed by the parties. The multilateral fund is completely, the decisions under the multilateral fund are taken by representatives of the parties serving as members of the executive committee. The decisions on non-compliance or compliance are taken by this implementation committee, which again is 10 parties that are taking the are doing the studies and doing the recommendations to the meeting of the parties. This non-compliance procedure is built on trust and assistance rather than punishment and embarrassment. And this shaking hand is supposed to represent this spirit of the non-compliance procedure and the implementation committee. It's really interesting. I mean, if we consider all the obligations that the parties have had under the Montreal Protocol and the non-compliance cases that we have been dealing with, we can see that there is over 98% of full compliance of all the parties with their obligations under the Montreal Protocol. So that's a fantastic achievement of the parties, of the governments under the Montreal Protocol. Here, I would like to try to give some opinion on what is the driving force behind all these achievements, and what is it that keeps the world going and working under the Montreal Protocol. And to me, it is clear that the governments of the world have faced many challenges in these 24 years, challenges ethical, moral, technical, economic challenges, as well as technological and commercial challenges. So it not has been an easy ride, so to say. It has been a very tough years in these 24 years of the implementation of the Montreal Protocol. However, in all those difficult challenges that have been faced, the parties managed to address them through often very tough negotiations and very difficult reconciliations, and most of all, through sometimes a painful consensus building process, through which the parties, the governments, have managed to address the difficult problems that they have been facing. So, as a testimony of how successful the governments have been in this Montreal Protocol, I have to say that never ever in the history of the Montreal Protocol, parties have taken a vote on any issues. All the decisions, as painful as they may have been, were taken by consensus. And this is a great tribute to the trust and confidence that parties, governments of the world, have built in the Montreal Protocol. So I believe that behind all this, achievements and the principles and etc., what I can describe as potentially being able to explain all this success is the partnerships. And the partnerships are one of the key elements in the history of the Montreal Protocol and the protection of the ozone layer. The Montreal Protocol has been exceptionally successful in bringing together the nations and the different stakeholders in the international community to work in a global partnership. There have been strong partnerships among governments, industry, academia, media, and civil society. There has been a very strong partnership between nations, developed and developing nations. There has been a strong partnership between science and policy. And these partnerships, I believe that all the contributors to these partnerships have demonstrated that once governments of the world can stand on common principles, and they have this sense of responsibility and this positive spirit towards giving and take, we all can work together to see the light at the end of the tunnel in these sometimes very difficult international negotiations. So here I still have a few other slides, so I want to ask you whether you would like me to continue, or That's the second question or the second deal. It's only four more slides. So how do you feel, Carmelina? Do you feel okay? Carmelina? Okay. So so I would like to talk about the challenges, and very briefly I will touch on two or three challenges only. One of the real challenges that we are facing now is the phase out of HCFCs, which are the transition substance that that was used to phase out most of the ODSs. You can see here that that is the that is the consumption of the world. This slide here describes